right, Aftershocks TV. Thanks for everyone for joining me once again this week for another episode here. And we got a couple of gentlemen. One you've seen a few times here on Aftershocks over the years. I think it's the fourth time we've had him on here. But we got the guys from Sons of Silver. We got, of course, guitarist Peter Argyropolous. And we got bassist Adam Kury joining us today. What's up, guys? Thanks for coming on. Appreciate it.
Thanks for having us, Matt. Great to be here.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, absolutely, guys. Well, guys, let's, Peter, just real quick, I was, as I was watching the video for Telling Me This, you know, right after the video, obviously, Read 'Em Their Rights popped up, man. I just can't believe it's been over 4 years since you guys put out the Doomsday Noises EP.
It's nearly 4 years. It's like, you know.
Is it?
Three months. So, you know.
Oh, you're right. Well, actually, it's March, right? So it's almost 4 years, I think, to the day with the pandemic, I should say. But but almost 4 years, man. I can't believe how long it is. But let's get into it, guys. Tell Me This. All right. So latest single from Sons of Silver off the upcoming full-length Runaway Emotions that's coming out pretty soon. And we'll get into that in a little bit. But first full-length for you guys now after two EPs to start your career. With the band, just another excellent track on this one. I love it. I love that main riff. It kind of reminds me a little bit of like an older, like sort of AC/DC type of riff. It's just got that, you know, just that good old school rock and vibe to it. It's got great hooks throughout. It's got, you know, it's just a catchy song like you guys, are known for. You write some great catchy riffs and hooks on all your tracks. I believe I read somewhere that this track was originally, I guess, shelved. Right. And then you guys brought it kind of back, or at least the riff itself was, I think, shelved. So talk, I guess, about Tell Me This and the reasoning, I guess, why you kind of shelved it and then brought it back as the first single off the new album.
It was shelved because it wasn't quite happening. I brought the riff to the band. It was just sort of like a guitar in front of the TV exercise for me. I brought it to everyone and I had an idea of some chord changes for a chorus and some melody for a chorus. And it was originally called Now Hear This. And we worked on it, you know, for a few hours, maybe over a couple rehearsal sessions. And you know, we were starting to get somewhere with it, but it wasn't quite getting over the top. And we had other priorities. So we shelved it. And often we'll do that because we don't want to beat something up. If we think there's something there, but we're not quite able to make it happen, we'll just sort of set it aside. Let it stew a little bit in the back of our minds and wait for, you know, another time when we can, you know, take a crack at it and see if we can, you know, push it over the top, so to speak.
Yeah. Shelved is kind of a misleading term. It wasn't so much that we put it away because we didn't like it. We just knew we hadn't finished it.
Yeah.
So sometimes when you get to a certain spot, you kind of have to like put something down and clear your head and come back to it and try and get a fresh perspective. So that's what we really had to do with this one.
Yeah.
Okay. So what was it that, I guess, you know, made you realize, well, let's kind of throw it out there again and see if it stuck? I think I did read something about with Mark, you know, now in the fold as the drummer. That's what kind of, was that one of the reasons why you brought it back? Because he's got maybe more of a straight up rock. And I mean, from what I hear, he's just more of a straight up rocker, maybe compared to Dave, who I know was, more, you know, a very finesse drummer who could do, I mean, pretty much anything. He could rock too, but he was definitely more of a, I think, a finesse type of drummer.
I think it was a new guy and a new perspective. He was hearing it for the first time with fresh ears. And also we all picked up some energy having, you know, a new person. It's when you change things up a little bit, you go from being really nervous to, can you get somebody that's going to do the job the way we need it to be done, more flow wise than anything else. And then once you realize that you've got somebody that's doing it, then you're excited. Then it was like, hey, well, let's have a shot at this one.
Yeah, that was basically, in fact, they actually play, there are a lot of similarities between the two in the way they play the drums, you know, and not necessarily the way they approach the drums, but the way they play is very similar, their feel, I should say. Mark is more, there's a more punk sort of energy to him. He hits the drums harder, not too hard, but he hits them a little harder with more authority, I should say. So that lends itself, you know, to more rock and roll, straight ahead rock and roll songs. Like Adam said, it was just new energy. We were excited. And in the meantime, I had done a little work on it, on the song. I had, you know, tweaked the chorus melody a bit. I had revised the chorus lyrics, still didn't have the rest of the lyrics, But then when I brought it back, there was something for us to work on, you know, as far as, okay, we know what we had before wasn't happening, but now there's a new twist to it, so let's work on that. And likewise, we had the new energy in the band, and Mark really took to it, so that really helped push it along as well. If I remember right, it was really, you know, everyone had chimes in, but it really, Adam and Mark really tightened that thing up and helped push it over the top.
Okay, very cool, very cool. Well, now, of course, too, lyrically, you know, obviously, Peter, the one line that sticks out, and I'm sure you've gotten asked this a lot, do you recognize my ass on your lips? Yeah. You know, I know, speaking to you before, that sometimes, you know, when it comes to your little, you know, your lyrical approach when you're writing, you've mentioned that you like to, I mean, it's something I think you do really well, is you like to find sort of a line or something that'll, you know, it doesn't really necessarily have a ton of meaning to it within the song, but it's written in order really just to grab the listener and give it that hook. I remember you telling us that with, obviously, Read Them Their Rights, and how that was kind of thrown in there as well. It just kind of, you know, someone's, you know, you said it or something, it just kind of stuck. It didn't necessarily have so much of a meaning with the song. So was that the sort of the same thing here? Was it something that you just wanted because it just obviously grabbed the listener like it did with me, and I'm sure lots of other listeners out there?
Yeah, I mean, that one, the lyrics were a struggle. I've mentioned in other times in the last few, you know, month or so here, the lyrics were a struggle. I really wanted to make it a bit of a political rant, protest, like a mini anthem, and I wasn't going to let that go, and that concept, but I was forced to because it just wasn't happening. So within that, you know, I took elements of what I had been working with on the political rant side of things, and I weaved them back into what was the final concept, which is kind of just, you know, failed, you know, you're basically your crazy ex, you know, in your life again briefly, and you're reminded that, you know why you ended that one. But I was able to weave some of those political things in there, but I was missing something at the end that had bite, that more than anything satisfied me as a singer and the deliverer. So I was cycling through different ideas, and this was the you know, do you recognize my ass on your lips? It was just something that it makes sense within the context of the song. It made a lot of sense to me, and when I sang it for Brina, who our keyboardist and engineer, who, you know, tracks my vocals, also my wife. Forgot that part, but so priorities, right? Anyway, so, you know, when I sang it for her, she was like, oh, that of your choices, that one really stands out. Then I sang it for Kevin, our guitarist, who was in the studio that day, and he dug it, and then gets passed around to Adam, Mark, a few other folks, and everyone liked just the way it sort of stings at the end of the chorus, and that's how we land on it. And it didn't come out of nowhere in the sense of like, it's just like just random phrase. It's just, you can twist your words in so many different ways with one phrase, especially a final phrase or an opening phrase, you know, and this one sort of shapes it in a way that, you know, it's just got a bit of a to it, and
yes,
makes it fun.
Yeah.
You got to have some fun with it every once in a while, right?
Yeah. Absolutely. No, it is fun, man. Like you said, it definitely grabs you. You know, and let's talk about the video, too, for the track. You know, I mean, that's a really cool video. The concept, it's got that 60s, you know, mod album cover art. And I like that beginning part, you know, before the song starts, where you guys are all kind of walking into the frames and your stripes there individually. Talk about that video. I mean, where, you know, who put that together? That was a really cool concept, something that's really different I haven't really seen. You know, it's really cool.
The director was David Wolfgang. He's he does a lot of TV stuff and some films as well. It turns out he's the husband to Brina's best friend. He's the husband of Brina's best friend, and we've known each other for quite a long time and wanted to work together, but he's frankly been always traveling about the country doing shooting different shows and the likes of that. And we finally, we hooked up over this past Halloween, and he's like, dude, he goes, we got to do something together and send me some songs. So I sent him a couple songs. He's like, I'll do any of them, but I, you know, which is the first one. So I brought up this one. So he came back to me with a concept, And you know, and frankly, at first I was like, this is really cool. But we have a videographer we've been working with for a while who's done most all of our other stuff, a guy named Ryan Calavano. And we were trying to stick with him, but we couldn't get our schedule to work out with him. So I said, you know what, David, let's do it. And he was really enthusiastic. He put the whole concept together with his editor and co-producer, a guy named Sal Scalafani. Yeah, let me step back here. Let's put this in there. He put it together with Sal Scalafani, his editor and co-producer. And really, we had nothing to do with it. The only thing that we knew was the mod art concept, which ironically, Brina had thrown in her lookboard as video ideas. They chose from the same theme, and it was, they were actually pulling from a Dave Brubeck in London album from the mid 60s, and that was it. The rest of us just showed up and did our thing, and you know, it was great. We shot it all in what, 10, 12 hours, and I got to give full credit to him. And yeah. Oh, I want to add one thing. That intro walking sequence that you mentioned. Mm-hmm. So two things to that. One, we're watching this go down. I remember we're all laughing, you know, behind the set, because we're like, he was explaining what the concept was to us and how it was all going to work. And we had to do a couple of retakes or recuts of certain scenes to make sure it sequenced right. But I remember watching, we're taking bets. We're like, there's no way this is going to work. We're going to have to scrap this idea. We'll just cut straight in the songs. There's just no way. It was too confusing how they would edit it all together. And miraculously, they did. And then secondly, when they sent it to us, or we all got to watch it, we thought, well, you know, it's a long intro. Is anyone going to get it? And we were like, fuck it. We like it. We love this long intro. It's so not appropriate to these times too, and everyone's just like swipe, 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 swipe after like, you know, 5, 10, 15 seconds. But we stuck with it. And I remember, I think Adam was the first one, was like, no, man, this is cool. Let's go with it. So that's where we ended up. We'll be right back.
really cool. So yeah, I mean, now with you guys also, now you got a big time mixer, obviously, that mixed this record for you guys. Tim Palmer, who obviously he's, you know, done so many, you know, records. I mean, Pearl Jam, he did 10. He's, of course, you know, done a ton of those British bands, you know, Tears for Fears, The Cure, he did David Bowie, Ozzy, Robert Plant, so forth. So how'd you wind up connecting with too. Tim? I mean, that's a huge get right there, obviously.
They were referred to us by our folks at, he was referred to us by our folks at Universal. Yeah. Oh, wow. And I was pretty surprised that we were able to lure Tim in. It was one of those things where, you know, someone says, okay, give him a shout, connects us. I give him a shout. He says he's really busy. I sent him a track, said, please. And he says, oh, I'll absolutely get involved. And he mixed the first track. He nailed it. And we got on the phone and talked some more after that. And he was like, I'm into this. Let's do the whole album. And, you know, Adam can tell you, he should tell you. I mean, he brought so much to the table. Just finishing touches on things, because we're self-produced. It's just the five of us working together. Brina's our engineer. She's in the control room. The rest of us are in the tracking room, and that's it. So we don't have any outside perspective. We rarely share much of anything outside of the five of us while we're writing and recording. So to get ears and experience from someone like him, not just because he's had hits, because it's stuff that we really love. That, I mean, he's made records that we love. That was huge, massive, cannot be underestimated.
Yeah, that was a big get. It was a big get for us, and not just that he is that good and he's done all those things, but most importantly, I think what he did for us was what needed to be done. He brought all the right elements. Whether it's just that he's that good and he got it and knew what to do, or whether his style fit what we needed, it just worked out perfectly for us.
Yeah,
fantastic. Yeah, now he's obviously one of the big ones out there, man. So that's a great get, obviously. And like you said, but from what I've heard, obviously, with the song, it's a fantastic mix. Now, you know, I was saying earlier, you know, this is obviously now your guys' first LP that you got coming out. And so, I mean, what approach, you know, if any, really, you know, as a band, I mean, or at least in your guys' case here, I mean, how do you approach, I guess, the LP being released, you know, promoting it, marketing, everything? How do you do that differently than, say, what you've done, obviously, with the EPs? I mean, obviously, you know, obviously, when you hear the word full length, there's obviously a different cachet and a different, it just tends to hold a lot more meat and juice than, you know, an EP. So is there anything been, you know, have you guys had to like do anything, obviously, more extra that you've had to done with the EPs? Are you guys just still kind of doing what you've done, obviously, previously? Walk us through that a little bit of how you're planning on, you know, working this record compared to the EPs.
We're making it up every single day as we go.
We're making it up as we go along.
We're literally making it up every day, or maybe I exaggerate, every week or so. I mean, even today, I was on the phone with you know, our publicity folks, and we're talking about, well, we have our next single dropping April 12th. Excuse me. It's a track called Just Getting Started. Mm-hmm. And like, okay, are we going to drop the music video with that? Because we didn't do the music video on the same day as the main track release for Tell Me This. We did what was called a backstory video, where we had a video of us in the studio working on the track. And then, you know, I don't know if you saw over it.
I did see it. I saw it. Yeah.
Scrolling, you know, sort of a bit of a backstory about the song. So we have one for this song, Just Getting Started, as well. Excuse me. I had a bit of a small cold, so just getting over it.
Okay.
Anyway, it's not the smoke, so
are you sure about that, Peter?
Exactly. Yeah. But anyway, so we're debating things like that, and we're sitting here, and that's like, okay, well, do we put this email around it on Friday or Thursday? Do we do it at 9 a.m. or 5? Little stuff like that. And the reality is that there is no rhyme or reason. There you try to get some type of regular routine, and there's a piece, there's some of that, maybe 50% of what you do, but the rest of it, honestly, break out the dice, see what feels good that day, and hope it works. And I know we're not alone in that. So that's the only part that feels, you know, feels good about it.
And the one big thing that I noticed in the difference, which is with today's world, you don't want to like just drop an album and then we're going to see it 2 years from now for our next release. You know, people, attention spans are kind of short, and there's so much going on out there that people will forget about you if you're not out there. So when you drop an EP, you can do that twice as often, right? You break it up into two. But the difference here is we're taking this approach where we're releasing singles, of like two or three of them ahead of the full length, so we don't just drop an album and walk away from it. So to me, that's the biggest difference. But yeah, we're making it up as we go along. I mean, Peter threw it out in the beginning of this is because we had a lot of songs. He's like, I think we should do a full length release. And we hadn't done one. So then we really took a lot of time to figure out, well, what does that mean for us? How do we approach it? And like you said, you just try something and see if it works. And if it does, do it again.
Yeah. And I'll add to that, that, you know, it, as Adam said, which is key, it's the most important thing, your attention spans are short. And even, even when people are fully with you, engaged, they can quickly forget about you because, you know, they're the next day, an hour later, whatever, there's something else pulling at them. And I find that even for myself. And so what I started noticing was those artists whom are, you know, in your face, so to speak, or in your eyes and ears on a regular basis, weekly, daily, with something of quality, not just, you know, this is what I'm having for lunch, you know, and here I am, you know, standing, you know, outside the venue, pointing my finger up and going, you know, peace or whatever. But, you know, something of some content that's maybe perhaps a bit timeless, that that allows you to then, you know, stay in people's eyes and ears, maybe pull them in more, especially if they're, you know, just getting to know you. And so that's kind of the general strategy that we're working within is stay out there with quality content and keep reminding people. And, you know, on that note, like, I'll say that one of the things that's a strong reminder of that is for me, at least, was a band like U2. In this last several months, we know they did the Sphere tour, and they did it without their main drummer, and you know, with their founding drummer Larry Mullen, and you know, there were a lot of people, including myself, were like, "Are you guys nuts? You know, go out without him, take more time off." But I think they recognized that one, it was a great opportunity to play there, be the first act to at the Sphere, that is, and secondly, you know, they still want to stay relevant, so they need to stay out there doing stuff. And you look at then all the promotions they put around that, the little video clips that they do, you know, or the shorts and the likes of that. And I'm like, if these guys are hustling like that, we better get off our asses and make sure we do it too. Cause they don't have to, there's nothing, sure. They don't have anything to prove. And that they recognize that that's just what's required in today's world. And I think most folks are, you know, artists are now really recognizing that and stepping it up as best they can.
Yeah, well, like they said these days, you know, you're not just a musician anymore. You're a marketer on top of it. I mean, you got to do everything. It's not just playing the music and then, you know, label takes care of everything. Obviously, you know, like you said, you've got to do all that. And so when you guys, you know, initially then form, when you put out Doomsday Noises, you know, it's like you guys have obviously done, I think, what a lot of new, you know, bands would do when they first start out. They put out an EP or two, release some singles, and then release the full length, which is what you're doing now. Was that sort of the plan from the beginning, or is it, like you said, you've just been, as you're going along, you said you're making it up. I mean, is that just kind of, did you guys have a plan when you started, like knowing how you wanted to sort of progress, you know, slowly? Because like you said, the attention span is so short, you know, people hear your album or hear whatever, it's great, and they forget, you know, on to the next thing, you know, a couple of days or a couple of weeks later.
No, we knew we wanted to take some time, and we've known for months what the first few singles would be. And we may even get four or five singles deep. We'll see how they each go. But the album was really wrapped up over the summer. Mixing of it and mastering was done by the early fall. So we've had quite some time to sit on it and reflect how we wanted to you know, release things. And we knew for sure we wanted to put out a few singles to begin with. We thought we were going to be at a faster pace, but Tell Me This has been doing really well for us. In fact, we got our Universal special notice today that we streamed really great over the last couple of days in particular, which is always fun. And did you get that one, Adam, by the way?
I did say that's good.
So anyway, you know, so with that being the case, we're extending this the life, at least the initial lifespan of this song. There'll be a lot more to it, you know, but before the next single, that is. And you know, But you start finding a routine, and part of that routine is you're just talking, well, what do we want to put out next? What's appropriate? We have all these assets to choose from, you know, that we had, for instance, the Matt Pinfield interview, which was, you know, been very
great.
Very good for us. So,
Well, and I think also, you know, we kind of want to time the release of the full album with being out there on the road. And we got a lot of feelers out there for tours and things are coming. So in the meantime, if we keep dropping singles and videos and additional content, we keep the buzz hopefully going and building. So when those come through, we can drop the full release and really let it fly.
Yeah. So are you guys not planning to tour? I guess that obviously now is something you're gonna do full on now. I know it's been I know during the pandemic, obviously you couldn't really do much, but so that obviously now that's my other question was obviously you release a full length, I would assume that a tour is gonna follow with that is so that's in the plans.
That's the hopes.
Yeah, that's in the works right now. I mean, we're grinding at that one to iron out details and stuff and mm-hmm. get the right touring opportunity. We don't want to just go out and mm-hmm. Be on stages where we don't belong, or it's just not not the right place for us. So, and that takes mm-hmm. some work, but it's all coming together. And frankly, once we get out on the road, we hope to stay out on the road for quite a while.
Oh, really? Very cool. Oh, that's excellent. So, I was mentioning earlier about obviously Doomsday Noises. It's been almost, like I said, 4 years. And just from my end, as a fan of the band, it's been really cool just really watching Sons of Silver to, you guys not only continued as a band, but really grow the way you have. I mean, especially because, like you said, you started out with that record, came out right and smack in the heart of the pandemic. Mm-hmm. Now normally when, things like that happen, and what's happened with a lot of bands for, during that time was it could obviously easily derail any momentum that the band has. And with you guys, it seems like it's been sort of the opposite. And I'm sure a lot of it has to do, I know, Adam, Peter's told me, obviously you guys have been, good friends for years. Obviously you've got, Verena, your wife in the band. So there's already strong relationships there, but it seems like if anything, the pandemic sort of, it seems like it almost made you guys sort of stronger in some ways. And maybe, like I said, maybe did that have to do, you think, with anything in terms of I guess there's no expectations or no pressures when you're just coming out new, when you've got this music out, you can't tour nothing. So there's really not any sort of expectations or nothing. But do you think it actually allowed you guys, just having that pandemic, allowed you guys to then take it just easy going, take it one step at a time, putting out your EPs, little by little, and just kind of sort of methodically doing it at that pace? Because like we said, when bands have any sort of momentum that gets lost, it's so hard to get that momentum back. And then obviously there's usually not great things that happen after that. So do you think that's allowed you guys to really grow, even though it wasn't really a good time or a thing at the time, but may have in the end be kind of beneficial to you guys overall as a band?
Do you want to take that one first, Adam?
Sure. I mean, it was. I mean, it wasn't. Obviously, no one could predict that coming and hitting us and all that. And
time out.
Yeah. Well,
Peter did. Yeah.
Artistically. Yeah. But the whole thing was you have to remember at that time we had just started to tour that, and then we recorded that EP. And when we released that EP, when the pandemic hit, most of the songs for the second EP were already in some sort of development. So we had this plan of going and just dropping EPs and continuing to tour. And once we couldn't, that's when the idea of digging in and getting a full length. We had some other things to deal with. Dave decided he was changing, going on to do some other things in his world. So we had that to deal with in that process. But mostly we just kind of said, look, we've got this time. We can either sit on our thumbs because no point in releasing a whole bunch of stuff that we can't support, although we did release a second EP. But we were like, this has already been done work. Let's take this time and really push it. Let's write more stuff. When this is over, let's come out of this with a whole bunch of new stuff that we can use to approach and jump back on. So, I mean, I feel like it's worked out pretty well considering, but I don't think there's any way to really scheme it like that. We just basically made the choice that we're going to work.
Yeah, it was a survival. We enjoy making music together. We enjoy hanging out with each other a lot, and we believe in what we're doing, and we think there's not just some good music there and some cool shows to be played behind them, but there's something more substantial, and we stuck it out, and to be honest with you, it was difficult. It's really, it's good to emerge from that because it was difficult for everyone, but for us, because we had a lot of momentum going into Doomsday Noises, we were, mm-hmm. We had some pretty high expectations, and we weren't alone in that. And, you know, like others, it got derailed. So we had to, you know, reassess our schedule, our planning, and how we were going to keep it together. Oops, sorry. It's a reminder for my son, but not anything important here. Anyway, nonetheless, we had to regroup, and we found the best way, as Adam mentioned, was to, you know, continue writing, recording some new songs, and just be ready. And you know, we've kept ourselves kind of like Minutemen, and ready to go at a moment's notice for, you know, any type of situation, be it a live stream, a show, whatever. Mm-hmm. And it's paid off for us, because now we are in demand, and we are ready, and not just with songs, but also, you know, emotionally, physically, playing wise, you know, stage wise. So, you know, it's been some work, but it's been well worth it.
Yeah, no, absolutely. Well, like I said, if you know, as long as you keep putting out the songs you have been, man, it's you know, you're gonna make a lot of your fans happy with obviously what you've been doing, and you keep doing. And so, yeah, so I mean, in terms of the new album now, I mean, you got an album title. Any idea when it's gonna be out? I mean, I know, remember hearing something about late spring, early summer. Is that sort of still the timeline for that?
Summer.
Okay.
Yeah, we don't have an official date. We're just, as soon as we feel like, hey, this is the time to do it, we'll drop it.
There we go. Sure. That's the answer for you.
But it's ready to go. We could release it tomorrow if we want.
Yeah, I mentioned earlier, it's been ready to go for months. But yeah, I mean, basically, we're just feeling it out single by single, seeing what's going on, seeing how the schedule, the touring schedule, live show schedule lines up. So it you know, obviously it's not going to be at a drop of a hat where someone's going to be like, you know, coming out tomorrow. But
sure.
That said, you never know. I would say sometime by mid late summer would be, you know, but that would be my guess.
That's great. Well, I mean, I guess that's the benefits. Well, you said when you're doing everything yourself, you can just, you don't have nobody at the top telling you get it out now, hurry up type of thing. So, yeah, that's fantastic. Well, in the meantime, everyone can go ahead and they can check out the latest single for the video, Tell Me This, Sons of Silver. It's out now on all the streaming platforms and video platforms. And so, guys, what's the best place to send everyone to keep up with all things with the band, and where they can kind of purchase anything you guys get out there and all that good stuff?
I think the best thing is just to search Sons of Silver, whatever, you know, browser or search engine you use, search Sons of Silver. You'll find our website, obviously, but you'll be taken to Facebook if that's, you know, that's your place. If you like Instagram, you find the links there. It's, you know, it's when we chose the name, one of the things we did was make sure that the name was easily findable, in the sense that there weren't any competing, not necessarily even competing bands, but some names that you know, could sort of steal people's attention elsewhere. So Sons of Silver is now stamped. It's ours.
All right. Fantastic. Well, there is some Sons of Silver, Tell Me This. Be prepared for the new record coming out this summer, the first LP from the band. And guys, Adam, Peter, thank you guys both so much for coming on Aftershocks. I appreciate you taking the time. And yeah, hopefully we'll see you out on the road sooner than later, of course. And yeah, I'll be checking it out.
Absolutely. Yeah. Matt, thanks. Thanks for reaching out. And thanks so much for having us, man. It's great. Absolutely.